Good evening, everyone. I would like to introduce you again, well, some of you again, to our distinguished visiting lecturer for the winter term, Rabbi Lindsey. Currently, Rabbi Bat Joseph serves as director of the Sol Mark Center for Jewish Excellence in Vancouver, where she commits herself to the work of inclusion and egalitarianism in the Jewish community and beyond. Rabbi Bat Joseph also directs the Writing and Working Center at Alexander College in Vancouver and teaches philosophy and other subjects there at Alexander and at Simon Fraser University. Tonight, she will share with us a lecture entitled Dancing on Our Enemy's Grave, Coming to Terms with Victory and Peace. So please join me again in welcoming Rabbi Bat Joseph.
Have been taken captive. Israel's been dealing with this particular issue almost since independence was declared in 1948. It is something that is happening with increasing frequency to other countries, including our own. We're kind of caught, you know, because our citizens working overseas or simply on vacation suddenly find themselves at gunpoint or at knife point. Countries don't want to be seen to be negotiating with terrorists, but what about a government's responsibility to its citizens? War and the conclusion of hostilities have become far more complicated since the end of the Cold War. Complete victory has thus far eluded us. We've had some small ones. The deaths of key figures of various terror groups, such as Osama bin Laden, might be counted amongst them. So I'm going to begin tonight by contrasting two seemingly contradictory passages from Proverbs. All right? In the one side, it's telling us if our enemy fails, do not exalt. And on the other, it's saying, when the wicked perish, there are shouts of joy. So clearly, there seems to be a contradiction. Do we rejoice at the downfall of our enemies? Well, Proverbs 24:17 clearly says no. So does that mean that those crowds celebrating at the end of World War II were behaving immorally? Does it mean that we shouldn't feel a sense of happiness when a terrorist has been removed from the scene? A midrash on this proverb, connected with the Passover story, has bearing on two Passover traditions. The first concerns the recitation of what we call the Hallel. These are poems of praises. They are excerpts from various psalms, and they are poems of praise and rejoicing. They are sung at all the major festivals on the Jewish calendar. Passover, Pesach as we call it, lasts 7 days, as does our fall harvest festival, Sukkot. During Sukkot, we read the full Hallel, the full range of these poems and songs of celebration on each of the 7 days. On Pesach, we read the entire Hallel only on the first night, the first night Seder, and on the first day of the festival. So why not throughout the entire festival? I mean, this is the celebration of our liberation from slavery. What the sages teach is we don't celebrate, sing this celebratory passages on every day of the festival because Egyptians died during Pesach and because they suffered during the plagues. The second tradition has to actually do with the Passover Seder. There are four cups of wine drunk during the course of the service, the Seder. Wine is a symbol of joy in Jewish tradition. During the Seder, the story of our enslavement in Egypt from the book of Exodus is recounted. And as each of the 10 plagues is read aloud, the custom is to spill out a little of the wine as each plague is recalled. So then symbolically, what we're doing, of course, is reducing that amount of wine, reducing that amount of joy. Why do we diminish that amount of joy? The same answer, because of the suffering and death that the Egyptians experienced. And yet another midrash, connected also to the Pesach story, teaches that when the Sea of Reeds was parted and Israel was allowed to pass through on dry land, of course the waters then came over and drowned, or started to drown, the soldiers of the Pharaoh. At that point, the Midrash tells us that the angels in heaven, and the heavenly hosts, broke out in song, rejoicing at their deliverance. And when the Pharaoh's chariots became caught in the sea, and the angels burst into this song, God then rebukes them. Because as God explains, these are also the work of my hands, and they are drowning. And you would utter song. So these customs clearly are in keeping with 24:17, right? We don't celebrate the death of our enemies. Okay, but what about 11:10? What do we do with that? All right, in Jewish exegesis, that proverb is generally cited in connection with stories about justice and judgment, specifically judgment in capital cases. So as the teaching goes, serving as a witness at a capital trial can be very difficult for the jurors and for the witnesses because the blood of the executed is on their hands. The fate of someone's life is in their hands. So the Mishnah says that that even though the process of justice often causes pain, there is also some enjoyment of the good, knowing that good has been served. Hence the Proverbs teaching, when the wicked perish, there is rejoicing. So some sort of balance needs to be required. Is there such a thing as carefully restrained joy? And then, you know, maybe it's okay to celebrate in a way that is not quite euphoric, but at least acknowledges that that what has happened is for the ultimate good. So let's explore this question a little further. The question of the death of our enemies, with two pictures that again are in stark contrast with one another. Okay, in 2011, the U.S. Navy SEALs led a highly covert operation in Pakistan. They killed Osama bin Laden in his hideout in Abbottabad, and then buried him at sea very quietly without a great deal of fanfare. Now, the news, as I mentioned earlier, led to some very spontaneous, rather rambunctious celebrations all over the USA. In fact, the front cover of the New York Times that day, you know, in great big letters declared, "We got it." Thousands assembled to celebrate outside the White House. Hundreds of New Yorkers gathered in Times Square and at Ground Zero, the site of the, what had once been the World Trade Center. There were celebrations at various universities and fireworks. As I say, there was kind of this spontaneous joy at this, quote, good news. And at the same time, there was a very subtle, sort of muted response from world leaders, including the U.S. government. And this is what raised the question for many Americans. You know, they wondered openly if this kind of celebration was appropriate. Are we goading our enemies into further attacks, or are what we doing, you know, just the simple celebration itself, is it somehow disrespectful? In 2004, Sheikh Ahmed Yassin was assassinated in Gaza by an Israeli missile. All right? Yassin, for those of you who don't know his background, was the founder of Hamas. It's an organization that is committed to the destruction of Israel. It's written right into its charter. He personally was responsible for ordering some very gruesome terrorist attacks. His organization has fired rockets that blew up cafes, shot children at point blank range. His activities, in one way or another, affected nearly every Israeli on a very deeply and very personal level. His death meant as much to Israelis as the death of Osama bin Laden did to America. But there was no dancing in the streets in Israel. And the question I wondered was why? And I think the answer, in many ways, is found in Jewish tradition itself. Our tradition overall teaches us to prize life over death. And so even the death of our worst enemy is not a cause for mass jubilation. There was certainly a feeling of pride, maybe even a little bit of quiet joy. The deaths of men such as Yassin, Arafat, and others have never been the cause of the kind of celebration that the U.S. indulged in when bin Laden was pronounced dead. Not even among the extreme right wing. So connected to all these battles with various forces of terrorism is the gruesome specter of also trying to recover the kidnapped victims. In Jewish tradition, we have this principle of pidyon shebui, which is redeeming the captives. And this is where, certainly in contemporary circumstances, this has become much more difficult. At the end of World War II, when German soldiers and Japanese soldiers were released from POW camps, they were sent back home. The expectation was they would go home, they would go back to being citizens, and would resume normal civilian lives in much the same way as our soldiers coming home from the war front. In the contemporary reality, when we But once they did establish it, they're kind of stuck with it, because anyone that they release from there could potentially not only just return home, but also return home to launch another attack. And on the flip side of that, of course, we have seen our own citizens from Canada, as well as from other countries around the world, who have been kidnapped when they've been working overseas as aid workers of one sort or another, contractors with oil companies, and even people who are just simply out for a vacation. So how do we deal with this also, this mitzvah, this commandment in Jewish tradition of redeeming the captives? Mishnah 18, 18 is a, well, the Mishnah is a tractate of Jewish legal teachings. Gittin is a tractate within the broader Mishnah. The Mishnah usually comes, and what it tries to do is explain and expound on different points of Jewish law. So usually it starts with something that might be mentioned in the Bible somewhere, specifically in the Torah, which is the source of most of our religious traditions. And then it will expand on it and explain it. And the Mishnah is kind of the core of what ultimately became the Talmud. So in Jewish tradition, Pidyon Shebuim is considered to be a mitzvah, a holy commandment, something that we have an obligation to fulfill, and it is a kindness of the highest order. It overrides other religious considerations. So this particular Mishnah excerpt makes reference to the value of a captive, right? And in its day, this text would have been compiled in the early decades and early centuries of the Common Era. So what's the value of the captive? Well, this was generally understood to be the market value of a slave of similar age and physical condition. I don't know about you, but I've never had to value a slave in my entire life. I'm sure most of you have not ever had that experience. So we live in an age, and thankfully a society, where it's pretty safe to say that none of us knows even what that would mean, right? What would be the value? We talk about the value of human life, and even that is not something that we can put a consistent value on. We are many, many generations, thankfully, removed from slavery and slave markets. So how do we determine what a prisoner exchange or the cost of redeeming a hostage is worth? All right, so I'm going to focus on a couple of Israeli examples because they are the ones that seem to catch all the news. But I also want to remember and recall that not so long ago, Melissa Fung, one of our own CBC News correspondents, was stabbed and then also taken as a hostage from an Afghan refugee camp. She was held captive for 28 days, which is relatively short compared to sometimes the years that some of Israel's captives have been held. So every time there is a prison exchange in Israel, it is a major event in Israeli news. What typically happens is live prisoners who've been convicted of murder and or terrorism are returned to their home territories. And more often than not, what Israel gets in exchange is body bags and coffins. There is always a lot of public debate in Israel, both pro and con. And yet Israel still continues to try and redeem captured soldiers. So Gilad Shalit was taken prisoner in 2006 by Hamas. He was released in 2011. For a long time, though, there was a great deal of open speculation that he might actually be dead and that he might never be returned. In 2006, two other Israeli soldiers, Rudy Goldwasser and Eldad Regev, were both taken captive by Hezbollah when they were on guard duty. Their bodies were returned in 2008 in a prison exchange. Now, in the case of these prison exchanges, it often also means releasing many prisoners for one or two bodies. And so those who are very much against prisoner exchanges argue that it fails this fair value test. It puts more Israelis, they argue, especially soldiers, at risk of kidnapping. It emboldens the enemy, so to speak. And the imbalanced nature of these exchanges doesn't really provide a deterrence. In fact, those who oppose them argue that it actually encourages. It encourages more kidnapping. Now, on the flip side of the equation, there are also some very outspoken rabbinic and public and just ordinary citizens who argue, because Israel is a country where pretty much all adults serve in the national forces at some point. Army duty is a responsibility that all young Israelis have to take on. Their argument is, well, we can't ask young adults to serve if the government can't also make the commitment to do everything possible to bring them home. That the price that we're asking these kids, and they are kids, many of them, they're 18, 19, 20 years old, the price we're asking is too high. The debate continues to rage on in Israel. It's not an easy issue, and there are no easy answers. And more recently, there have been raids in parts of the world where Al-Qaeda or ISIL-inspired terrorists attack tourists, often kidnapping several. So we've seen buses driven into crowds, we've seen markets blown up, we've seen people taken captive while they're on vacation. There have been very public, as in internet broadcasts, of beheading of these captives, which horrifies us, and that's in part the point. Our government and others take the stand that they won't bargain with terrorists, but at the same time, they're also being criticized for not doing enough to bring citizens home. Many countries have many more victims of terrorism on record. I was looking at some statistics over the weekend. Between 2001 and 2015, according to a National Post report, 53 Canadians were killed overseas in terrorist attacks of one sort or another. And despite the sharp contrast between the Canadian government's approach to this issue and Israel's approach to this issue, the results in both cases are equally mixed. We got Melissa Fong back. Israel got Gilad Shalit back. Canadians John Risdale and Robert Hall were murdered by Abu Sayyaf in the Philippines. Hudi Goldwasser and Eldad Regev, as I mentioned earlier, their bodies were simply returned to Israel. So we all want to see our people brought home safely, but we're left with these questions. What is the price of bargaining with those who are committed to doing us harm? And what is the price of not bargaining with them? And the answer in both cases is the price is very high. And it's an ongoing debate for governments, for many governments, in terms of what is the price we're prepared to pay? What is the price for doing nothing? What is the price for doing something? And what is the something that we can do that isn't going to be too expensive? There is no easy answer to this. So this whole issue, as I mentioned earlier, started for me in the wake of bin Laden's death. I was seeking answers to a moral question. Can we really, as the expression goes, or should we really, be dancing on our enemies' graves? We choose a very refined sense of black humor. I sometimes think, aside from our epic stubbornness, it's the only way we would have survived our history. So I want to end on a slightly lighter note with a not so lighter Jewish joke. Okay? So Hitler consults a psychic. He wants to know how long he would live and what kind of life he's going to have. The psychic assures him his name is going to go down in history. He's very excited about that. Die on a Jewish holiday. So he wants to know, of course, which Jewish holiday, and the psychic says, rest assured, whatever day you die will be a Jewish holiday. There is no Jewish holiday celebrating Hitler's death. Okay? There's a Holocaust Memorial Day that remembers his victims. There is an Israeli Independence Day, Yom HaAtzmaut, which celebrates the establishment of the modern state. And it is an establishing those two holidays, one right after the other, is they can't truly celebrate their country and what they've accomplished as a country without first remembering the price they've paid for it. So maybe we should look at moving Remembrance Day to June 30th, prior to Canada Day on July 1st. So the question then, all right, when we finally defeat ISIL, and I hope it's a when, not an if, when Hamas finally lays down its weapons and we finally welcome a true Palestinian state to the family of nations, will we dance on our enemies' graves? Well, Jewish tradition says no, we will not, but there'll be one hell of a celebration of peace. And that's the end that our tradition calls for. It's not the death of the enemies. I was talking to a young man over dinner about tradition connected with Yom Kippur, our Day of Atonement. It is not the death of sinners that God seeks, but rather they should turn away from sin, that they should repent that sin and make a fresh start. And in doing that, in committing to that, they can find redemption and they can also find forgiveness. And this is also what we want, right? Not the death of enemies, but the turning away from evil, the turning away from the intent to do harm. And as high-eyed as that might sound, we need to remind ourselves that it is achievable. And this is why it's achievable. Recall that Hitler's country, once our formidable enemy, a country that is responsible for 6 million deaths of my own brethren, is now one of Canada's and Israel's staunchest allies. Angela Merkel is a world leader that I admire greatly. So my prayer is that one day this will also be the case for our current foes, who currently seem so intractable, and currently seem like we're never going to actually win. I think the real win is not the defeat so much, is that at some point they will become our current foes will become our former ones, and that we will be able to move together as one people, and that we will all have a future that we can be hopeful for, and a way of life that we can all be proud of. So that's my little bit on dancing on our enemies' graves, and I'm happy to take questions or comments if anybody has any.
See each other as human beings and sort of
things like summer camps where Israeli and Palestinian children are brought together. It's with that specific kind of intention to break down those barriers so they can learn about each other and build friendships. Regardless of what's going on in the public face with Israeli politics, there are always back channels, and the back channels and the back doors tend to actually accomplish a great deal more than ever makes it into the newspaper. When I lived in Israel for a year for my first year of rabbinical school, and it was right after the Gulf War, and Ian and I were talking about this. When I went there, the Gulf War had ended, peace negotiations had opened up, and the sense of hope was palpable. Israelis were very excited and really believed at that moment that there might finally be a settlement. And of course, that isn't what happened, which I think is sad and unfortunate. But I think what's really important is that certainly on the ground floor, not always in Parliament, but certainly amongst ordinary Israeli citizens, that willingness to seek peace and to get to know one another and to build together has never really died. And there are far more Israeli citizens who are firmly committed to the two-state solution than there are members of Parliament. So that continues to give me hope, because I really do believe that the two-state solution is the right solution. It's the solution that will bring justice for both of our people. And I think with that will come peace.
My sense is that the current coalition government seems to be driven by the extreme right in Israel.
Yes.
Is that a fair assessment?
I think it is, actually, which is why whenever someone in this country starts talking about reforming the electoral system and going to proportional representation, I just go, because Israel has never had a majority government. It's the same kind of governmental chaos that we see in Greece and Italy and a number of other dysfunctional democracies around the world. So yeah, this is a problem. I mean, the bright side of the coalition is, yes, it is representative of the population, or at least the popular vote, and it does force all these disparate parties, they have to work together in order to be a government. The bad side of it is, in order to call together a government, you have to make these coalitions sometimes with people that you normally would never think of working with. And their agendas do sometimes drive things. We were talking about the Syrian situation earlier this afternoon, and I said I didn't see the hope of any really significant change in Syria until there was a change in the administration. And I kind of feel the same thing with the Palestinian-Israeli situation. There are a lot of things about Bibi Netanyahu that I admire, but I do not believe for a moment that he's committed to a two-state solution. I'm not sure that Mahmoud Abbas is either. And there's a lot of personal enmity between the two of them, and so that's getting in the way of it. So there's the politicians on the public level, and then yet on the ground level, you've got Israelis and Palestinians who are in joint business ventures together. They are opening schools with one another, deliberately trying to get Arabs and Israelis together to understand and work together. There are various peace organizations. Peace Now is very big in Israel and very global. So there's a part of me that just continues to hope. You know, I mean, it sounds very corny coming from a rabbi, but you know you have to have faith. And I do. I do have faith. I think ultimately if we find ourselves something that we are committed to, we'll make it happen. And I think there are enough people there that are committed to making it happen. It's the politics that takes time.
Hi, I read about a meeting in Paris this past, this current month, mm-hmm. in regards to the potential for a two-state solution. However, I don't know much about it. Can you talk about it?
I don't know much about it either. And I think this is what I mean about back channels, right? You hear about a meeting, but they don't really talk a great deal about what's going on in the meeting. And the problem is, the minute something becomes public, then you're dealing with not so much the reaction of the people on the ground, but other people who think they have a stake in it. So, mean, this has been one of the issues with peace in the Middle East on the whole. Egypt entered into a peace treaty with Israel, and the Egyptian president was assassinated very quickly after by his own people. I think one of the reasons that Jordan was able to sort of come to some accommodation with Israel in the way that they have, and there's, you know, essentially peace between Israel and Jordan, is because the king was very close to his death, right? They signed the treaty, he died anyway. There was no one to assassinate him, he died anyway. I am convinced that Yasser Arafat was taken out by his own people, and I think he was because he was close to signing a treaty. And I think this is also something that plagues a number of Palestinian leaders. They know the minute they make peace with Israel, Hamas or Hezbollah or some other like organization is likely going to try and take their life and could very well succeed. So I think it would take someone, in the current circumstances, extraordinarily brave to sign a peace treaty with Israel because you kind of know you're signing your own death warrant in the process. And so I think that's why when they have these sort of, you know that there's something going on, but we don't know exactly what's going on, I think that that's purposeful, that keeping it quiet serves the interests of everybody by not making public targets of everyone, but allowing some real negotiation to go on.
I believe that Trump wants to move the American embassy in Tel Aviv to Jerusalem.
Yeah.
Very scary because it's recognized. Jerusalem is recognized as a city that.
It's divided.
It's a divided city, but it's a city that brings together three faith groups.
Mm-hmm.
And giving one of those faith groups predominance is not going to be very.
I'm concerned about it too. I would feel, I think, less concerned about it if they were establishing, you know, an American embassy, you know, the American Israeli embassy in West Jerusalem, and they were also establishing an American liaison to the Palestinian kind of embassy in the Palestinian part of Jerusalem. I would, you know, it would be nice if there was some recognition on both sides. Trump is not known for a balanced approach to issues. And so we're not going to see much in terms of subtlety, nuance, or balanced approach to a lot of things, I think, for the next 4 years at least, potentially eight.
Let's hope not.
Pardon?
Sorry. Let's hope not eight.
Well, yeah, I mean, but we don't know, right?
So I'm looking Israel.
Well, I mean, the extremists are going to receive it very positively because they think it's validation and blah, blah, blah. I mean, the bottom line is, yes, he can say he's going to move the embassy to Jerusalem, but that could also take a long time before it actually happens. Right? And we don't know where in Jerusalem. I mean, the Knesset is in Jerusalem. The Knesset is not in Tel Aviv. So, I mean, it may end up being a tempest in a teacup. And then again, it could end up being something really significant. Like I think if they're going to do this, if they're really committed to doing this, then there has to be some kind of acknowledgement of the Palestinian Authority. And I mean, some kind of formal recognition, even if it's just a consulate, there should be something on that side of the city as well. Because ultimately, when there are two states, they're going to need an embassy in both countries anyway. And you know, that symbolically might actually be a great way to get things started, right? An embassy on both halves of Jerusalem, because this is going to be our embassy in Palestine when Palestine is finally established, and this is our embassy in Israel because Israel's already here. That would be, you know, hopeful at least. But then again, you never know what the reaction is going to be.
Getting back to your original presentation, is there any mention of restitution in Midrash?
There isn't specifically, because when we're dealing, as I was talking about earlier this afternoon, when we're talking about war in from a biblical context, and that's sort of the basis of where the Jewish law discussion comes from, It's not about reparations from either side to either side. It's how the war is conducted in the first place. And so there are some ground rules. And what has been codified in Jewish law is that infrastructure, not just trees, but infrastructure, period, should not be willfully damaged and demolished. And so there is a sense that if that destruction happens, that the people doing the destroying do need to make some repairs, do need to make some kind of restitution. So, you know, one of the ongoing issues, of course, in the Palestinian-Israeli dispute is the destruction of Palestinian homes and how to repair and restitute that. I think that's a relatively easy fix with some creative thinking. But then there is the whole land dispute to begin with. And, you know, I think what ultimately is going to happen in terms of borders is there's going to be losers on both sides, which will be very upsetting for those particular people. The key is going to be to get everyone to look at the bigger picture and so that overall both sides do win. Both sides get a state that is viable. Both sides are able to develop economies that will sustain their populations and that there, you know, is a lasting, peaceful relationship between the two. It's pointless to set up another state if they're just going to be perpetually at war. Which is, you know, I think another concern, right?
So, this makes me, what you're talking about makes me think of what Abraham Lincoln did at the Civil War with Reconstruction and the peace treaties with the South that they allowed some to keep the horses and guns on the side of farms and so forth. Or maybe even the Marshall Plan after the Second World War. Mm-hmm. Are those exemplary or examples maybe what you're talking about of the same principle? I don't know. But what would you say about those?
I certainly think that there's room for negotiating that kind of stuff. I mean, of course, I mean, one of the sort of hotbed issues is settlements, which it's a source of controversy, and I mean, some say it's a stumbling block. I think it's a stumbling block because the optics are bad. I think the political reality is that at some point Israel's going to end up abandoning a lot of those settlements that they're currently building or have built, because those settlements are going to end up being in the new Palestine. When Israel pulled out of the West Bank, there were settlements there that were, you know, that were also being abandoned. And the political situation at the time was they ended up blowing those settlements up because they couldn't allow those to be captured as, you know, as a sign of victory. And the fact that Israel pulled out was already being advertised as a victory. So, I mean, and at the time I thought that was really tragic because I knew that there were Palestinian homes that had been torn down by IDF for various reasons. I also know that this is a country that's trying to get off the ground and housing your citizens is important. And I think it would have been great if Israel had been in a situation politically to say, here's the keys, all you need to do is hook it up to your own power grid and your own water system, and you're good to go. And that would be nice if that's what happens with the settlements that are currently standing on disputed land. That would be the best case scenario. Whether that actually will happen depends on the nature of the settlement, you know, between the two countries. But I think there is potential there. I think for a long time, you know, when peace finally comes, I think the reality is that Israel and Palestine are going to end up being economic partners with one another in much the same way that Canada and the United States are. You know, the War of 1812 was very short-lived, thank goodness, and I mean, technically it happened before we were even a country. But, you know, we know how integrated we are, our economies. We don't just sell things back and forth, we actually build things together. And that sort of thing is already going on between Israel and some parts of the Palestinian territories. I expect that, you know, rationally, economically, that's going to continue. It will have to continue. And that's probably the best reason for them coming to some kind of settlement and reparations for one another in the first place.
Okay.
realities of a far off place, and but harsh reality is still here, but it seems very distant. So I'm wondering what you think can be done in places such as universities, especially in light of the recent, like the posters put up in universities of just total bashing of people. So I'm wondering, can you speak to the importance of people coming together from different religions and different personal beliefs, not just dwelling in their own circles, but being with people who are unlike them, who are not so like-minded, instead of talking about the political, what can we do to talk about the religion and how can that impact it, or does it impact it?
I think it can impact it, and I think in certain places it does. I don't like the term tolerance myself because it sounds more like you're putting up with something that you don't really like. I would prefer to work towards acceptance and diversity. And you know, when the term multiculturalism was first coined in this country, or the term cultural mosaic, a lot of people thought that that was a really weird phrase. But I've always really liked that image. Because if you think about a mosaic, it's all these little tiles that fit together to create a beautiful picture, a beautiful work of art. And if you look at some of the most beautiful mosaics, if you have too much of one color and not enough of the others, there isn't enough contrast, there isn't enough diversity. And the mosaic really isn't beautiful. And what holds all these different shapes and different colors together, of course, is the grout, the common values. And so I think the path towards acceptance and towards building on that diversity is to start by finding the common ground. And there is common ground. We're all human beings, so we have at least that much in common, and that's a place to start. I spent a lot of time working with the Edmonton Interfaith Center when I lived in Edmonton and had my pulpit here. As when I returned to university and was a graduate student at Simon Fraser, I had a lot of students in my class who came from places like Iraq and Iran, and I was probably the first Jew that they'd ever met in their life, face to face. In fact, I had a student pull me out of a lecture hall one day to tell me that she Googled me. I thought, you what? Like, I never even heard or thought of Googling a professor. And you know, she said, I Googled you and I discovered you're really a religious person. And I said, yes. And she said, yeah, but deeply religious. And I said, yeah. And she said, but that never comes up in the classroom. And I said, it's not my job in the classroom to indoctrinate you. I'm there to teach philosophy. But if you want to talk about religion, sure, we'll have a conversation. And we did. And she asked me things about Jewish tradition. I asked her things about the Islamic tradition that she had grown up in, her particular branch of Islam. And actually, yesterday morning when I was doing some prep notes for this talk, I got an email from her. She's now head of the Muslim Students Association at SFU, and she was inviting me to come and give a talk to them. And she said, we thought it would be great to have a rabbi come and speak to us. So, and I think that that's great. And I think it's really important for faith leaders, for those of us who are strong in our faith communities, to take those steps into other communities. So when I'm invited to speak, I usually jump on it, whether it's convenient or not, in terms of what else is going on in my life, because I think those opportunities are important. I think dialogue is a really important step. And the more that we can share of our own faith with other people, and the more that we can learn about those other faiths, the more of that common ground we find. And even when we come across the differences, you know, then we're in that zone of sort of explaining, okay, so why is it that you have this belief, and why do you do that? And even though you might decide that, okay, that's not something that I personally could accept or that I would believe in, at least you have a sense of where that person's coming from. And so you understand that individual or perhaps that faith group a little bit better, or that culture a little bit better. The college that I work for is 99% international students. So I learned a great deal about Chinese culture and Vietnamese culture and Indian culture, and I have a number of Iranian and Pakistani and Saudi students, and I'm now seeing students from Russia and Argentina and Mexico, and getting very different perspectives from these students because they will tell me what they think about their country. You know what? They're way more critical of their governments than we ever would be. So it is very interesting to see to hear their insights in terms of what bugs them and what they're happy with, what they like about Canada, what they don't like about Canada, what they like about their home countries and what they don't like about their home countries. And so it's just a case of seizing those opportunities for dialogue. And I think that faith has a role to play there. But we have to be respectful of our differences and embrace them. You know, if we were all the same color, all the same beliefs, this would be a really bland planet. You know, and who wants bland? I mean, vanilla is nice once in a while, but I'm still inclined to sprinkle cherries or something on my vanilla ice cream, you know, so a little spice, a little variety.
I think we need to learn to dance with the terrorists. It's not an easy thing.
No, I
agree. Because if you leave them out of the equation, peace may not be realized in time. You know, we tend to quite often name terrorists. You know, they are terrorists. That's from our perspective, from what they do.
Right.
You know, it's the same sort of designation was put on Nelson Mandela, Gandhi, Martin Luther King, Nkrumah, Nehru, but later on the same terrorists were at the negotiating table. I mean, it's not fair to make a comparison with some of the terrorist organizations in the East.
Yeah, I mean, sometimes there is a fine line. You know, one person's terrorist is another person's freedom fighter.
Right.
In some ways, it's history gets to judge, makes the ultimate judgment. The problem for us, of course, is we're not at a point where this is history, this is our reality. And so, yes, I mean, I agree with you. If there's an opportunity to negotiate, if there's a chance to be able to talk and come to some kind of agreement or settlement or something with these organizations, I think we should seize that opportunity. But again, if you're going to negotiate, you need all the stakeholders at the table. And if you pull out the chair and they don't want to sit down, then you're still stuck in that unfortunate position of having to respond to and react to their actions rather than being able to sit down and listen to their words. So it isn't an easy situation that we find ourselves in. And I think it may get a lot more difficult before it becomes manageable. We live in a time of great uncertainty.
This question is now a personal one.
Okay.
In the sense that it has to do with especially American evangelicals that seem to be working in Israel, and their work seems to be divisive.
It is.
And my understanding is based on that theology, but I'm not sure what that is.
What's going on, and when our Christian colleagues are shaking their heads and saying, they're crazy, I don't know what any kind of authority on the evangelicals. In fact, I mean, they're, sometimes I find them quite scary, to be honest with you. But then again, I will also tell you that I find right-wing extreme Orthodox Jews equally scary. So, I anytime you've got extreme, it's, I always aim for the middle. I think just the middle ground is a good place to, there's more room in the middle, right? There's room for more of us. That's kind of where I tend to gravitate towards the middle ground. Which is why I'm not Orthodox.
Well, let's thank Lindsey once again for joining us. Continue the conversations with each other, with Lindsey. If you have further comments.